Acts 4, and then the next week, Brother Cyril will be preaching on Acts 5 while I'm out, and then we'll just, and I'm really pleased with how things are going with that, and I'm enjoying working together with Cyril on this process. There is another announcement that I know I'm supposed to make that I cannot remember for love nor money. So at the prayer time, when I remember what else it is I'm supposed to say, we will get there. In the meantime, Christiana Ashong will come and help us orient ourselves in our community today.
Good morning, all. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end, but they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Amen. Once again, you are all welcome to Crossroads Presbyterian Church. And those of you watching us online, thank you all for joining. Announcements. Today is the first Sunday of the month, which is our communion service, whereby we break bread or we dine with the Lord. So be prepared. Save the date. Crossroads International Day takes off on October 19th. The church will be celebrating multiple cultures, serving one God. And also October 26th and 27th, Crossroads Church will be celebrating our 50th anniversary. Thanks be to God. Detailed information will follow soon. If anyone needs pastoral counseling, Pastor Jamie will be available on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Also, if you want to make an appointment, please call the church office. The contact number is in the hotline. Al Cottrell is still collecting clothing for the homeless. If you would like to donate, please leave your items in room 4. Help is needed at Reedon High School closed closet. Remember, Crossroads have a wonderful opportunity to continue our partnership with the school. Now the school needs our help to bring order to the closet. They need volunteers. If you are interested, please reach out to Dolores Rose. I think she's right here, somewhere. Okay, see Dolores Rose, her contact is also in the hotline. Operation Christmas Child. This month, they need donations of soap, washcloth, as well as toys, so that every shoebox can include both. But other items like non-liquid and non-food are also welcome. There is a donation box in the Nortex for that purpose. Maggie, you want to make an announcement?
Thank you, Christiana. I just want to say that if anyone is interested in being part of the platform worship team, so that's if you're a singer, a prayer, a player of an instrument, which could be anything from drums, melodica, trumpet, whatever you play, dancers, actors, people who can give a word of wisdom, can you please see Pastor Cyril or Susan, or myself? We would love to hear from you and see how we can draw you into the ministry. Thank you.
Amen.
If you are able, please rise to your feet as we worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. God, my God, how great you are. You are beautifully, graciously robed, dressed up in sunshine, and all heaven stretch out for your tent.
Never again will the whole earth be flooded. You created the plants, trees, the animals, and the people. with wisdom at your side. You made earth overflow with your wonderful creations.
Let us sing to God all through life. Sing hymns and speak praises to God every single day.
Oh, let our songs please him. May our thoughts honor him. We are so pleased to be singing to God.
We will rejoice and be glad in the Lord God Almighty.
As people called by God this morning, let us lift our voices in worship.
Take me home. What a joy.
my soul. How great thou art, how great thou art. Yes, Lord, say, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, my Savior God, to thee. Hallelujah. How great thou art, how great thou art. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Please
Amen.
Be seated. Please be seated. The scriptures tell us that Jesus Christ came to save sinners. I might see a couple in front of me right now. And behind me as well. This is our chance, as we hear the announcement of the gospel, to confess our sins. We do not confess our sins in hope that God loves us. We can, God loves us. We are free to confess our sins.
Let's pray in unison. Dear God, forgive us when we neglect to read your word, meditate and pray.
We miss the opportunity to absorb your wisdom and get insight into your world.
Even more so,
forgive us when we know your word and choose to ignore it. In the name of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Please stand. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. Christ died for you. Christ rose for you. Christ reigns in glory for you. Christ prays for you. In the waters of baptism, God claims us and calls us as his own forever. Therefore, in the name of Jesus Christ, I declare to you, you are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
And as the first act of a forgiven people, let us turn to one another and express the reconciliation that comes from God to us. May the peace of Christ be with you. Let us share the peace.
Congregation, if you are able to please stand to your feet. Crossroads, in whom do we believe?
Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son,
who was conceived
by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered and was Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
The third day he rose again from the dead.
He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father Almighty. From there shall I come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Our affirmation, our common identity. Who are we, Crossroads?
We are the people of God.
Why do we exist as a church?
To love God and worship Him, to love and care for one another, and to share the joys and struggles of glory as a community seeking to bring glory to His name.
Why are we here?
We are here to joyfully worship and serve the Lord, to share the message of Jesus the gospel with all who are here. Through lives that demonstrate love, mercy, and justice in all our relationships, in our community, in our nation, and in our world.
Crossroads, how can we be such a community?
By deciding to follow Jesus and to make a daily decision to live for today.
Earnestly studying His word
and seeking to help others. And to practice the principles found in His word.
Crossroads, for the glory of God, let us live like this.
Amen.
So we're going to continue. Oh, have I jumped the gun?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, Pastor.
Maggie has jumped the gun.
Oh,
you
yes,
may be seated.
Oh.
Now you'll, in a second, you'll know why she's embarrassed that she jumped the gun. Another person in the congregation who Maggie knows, Elder Michael Sofadia, has just returned from his time in Nigeria, and he's going to share with us a bit about his experience of God's presence there on this trip back home. I'm so sorry that Maggie ignored you, and we welcome you to say something.
Good morning, Crossroad.
Good morning. You have to be in close communion with the microphone.
Okay,
buddy.
All right, thank you. Everybody know who I am anyway, so my name is Chief Michael Sholimade Sofidia Senior. I traveled to Nigeria on July 12th, 2024, and I returned back home on August 25th. The king advised me of two vacancies for chieftaincy, and he wanted me to consider the opportunity to serve the community. My original plan was to go to Nigeria to have a 24th anniversary memorial for my mother, who passed in 2000, July 17. So the king asked me again if I will consider the position of chieftaincy. at that point, I say, okay, I will think about it. And after my mother's celebration, I still have about maybe 4 weeks to go. So I said, well, since I'm here, I will go ahead and, you know, take this opportunity to get the chieftaincy. So on July 27, 2024, I was installed with the title of chieftaincy, Chief Michael Shorimade Sofidia Sr. as Akpashe of Ijoku Egba Land. The role of Akpashe as a title holder in the community is for me to act as a mouthpiece for the king, to make pronouncement and enforce the king's decision. Ijoku is a town in Sango Ota in Ogun State. I was born in this town, but I moved to Lagos at the age of 7 years old. The chieftaincy came from my mother's lineage because I am the only son alive. It is appropriate for the king to bestow the chieftaincy to me because of my family status in the community. Thank God for modern technology. I can carry out my duties to the community, the king, the council of chiefs and ballets through social media, such as Zoom, or FaceTime video. Please watch the pictures and video made during this coronation.
The screen is working.
Oh. That was the coronation ceremony after I was installed. And the guy, the chief in the white, is the one that, you know, is designated to install me. Those are the well-wishers and some of my friends, some of the neighbors. That's my nephew over there. The hat is too big for me to wear today, so I can I cannot wear that at all. So I have to. No, I'm saying the hat is a big hat, so I can't. It's not something I can just wear every day. So I need to get something smaller to wear. And that's it. Thank you.
Shall we rise to our feet as we continue to raise our voices to God in song?
Jehovah has the final.
Oh, Jehovah, turn my life around. Oh, Jehovah, take my life around. Oh, he makes a way where there is no way. Jehovah has the final say. Who has the final say?
Jehovah has the final say.
I say, who has the final say in your life?
Jehovah has the final
say. Oh, Jehovah, turn my life around. Oh, Jehovah, turn my life around. Oh, he makes a way where there is no way. Jehovah has the final say. Jehovah, turn my life around. Oh, Jehovah, turn my life around. Oh, he makes a way where there is no way. Jehovah has the final say.
Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Yes, indeed, he has the final say. And isn't that amazing that we are in his final say as to what happens to us, what he gets us to do, how he gets us to witness for us in all manner of ways, whether it's being a chief, being a teacher, being a servant, or just quietly being a prayer warrior. And you know, we sang this song not long ago for him, remembering that he will spread his wings of mercy over us, around us. He guards us, and sometimes we don't even know what he's protected us from, but he has. So let's remember that and think, yes, holy, his holy overshadowing.
Spread your wings of mercy over me and guard my heart with true humility. No shadow of the darkness pressing in, only the holy overshadowing. Underneath your wings, overshadowing. No refuge will I seek but God alone. No hiding place save only at your throne. Only the cross, the blood to wash my sin. Only the holy overshadowing. Underneath your wings, overshadowing.
You are my shield.
be safe within. Beneath the holy overshadow,
you are my shield.
Underneath your wings,
Patience and Adolf, can y'all come up front? So we just heard from Michael that Africa gives, and Africa also takes away. Adolf will be returning to Togo for 3 months tomorrow. And so Pastor Cyril is going to pray for Patience and Adolf. We were going to pray for Adolf, but it seemed like we should pray for both of them now, shouldn't we? There we go. So.
If you would, family, extend your right hand. Father, we bless you for today. We thank you for the opportunity and the privilege of coming to you in prayer. We thank you that you are a good, good Father. You are the worthy one, and we love you today. We thank you, Lord God, for this faithful couple, this couple who shares of themselves freely. They give and they give and they don't ask for much. And I ask you, Lord God, to bless them right now. Pour out on them, supply all of their needs, everything, spoken and unspoken. Have your way in this household. We ask you for traveling mercies today for Adolf. We thank you, Lord God, that you have already ordered his steps. You've already cleared his path. You've already made a way. You've already blessed the pilots. You've already done everything possible so that he would have a smooth sail there and back. Thank you that the business that needs to be accomplished will be accomplished. Thank you that you will give him discernment, wisdom, give him utterance, help him say what he needs to say, and be quiet when he needs to be still. Thank you for all of that, Lord God, and for patience, I ask you for just that, patience. Allow her, Lord God, to stand strong while her husband is away. Help us, Lord God, to see to her needs. Help us to gather around her as the family that we are so that he can go and be sure that she is covered by her church family. Thank you, Lord God, for all that you're doing in the lives of your people. Thank you that you have gathered us from all over. And thank you that there are times when you send us all over. But in every situation and circumstance, you are God. We trust you. You do no bad thing, only good. And so we thank you for the goodness and the mercy that you will pour out over this family in these coming days and weeks until you bring them back. As a matter of fact, Lord God, I thank you for their reunion, whenever it is. I thank you that there will be joy in the midst of it. We bless your name today. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 So we continue in a spirit of prayer. There are many things for us to pray for. We will have times for silent prayer throughout. And whenever we have silence, feel free to pray for things either silently, or you're also quite welcome to pray things aloud, to mention a name or a situation. So let us pray. Almighty God and Jesus Christ, you taught us to pray. Guide us by your Holy Spirit that our prayers may serve your will and show your steadfast love through the same Jesus our Lord. Let us pray for the world. God our Creator, we pray for the world you have made. Overthrow evil powers, right what is wrong. Feed and satisfy those who thirst for justice. so that all your children may freely enjoy your creation and joyfully sing your praises through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for the church. Gracious God, you have called us to be the church of Jesus Christ. Help us to be one in faith and service, breaking bread together and proclaiming the good news to the world, that all may believe that you are love and turn to your ways through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for peace. Eternal God, you sent Jesus Christ to break down the walls of hostility that divide us. Send peace on earth and put down greed, pride, and anger, which turn nation against nation and race against race. Speed the day when wars will end and the whole world accepts your rule. We pray especially for Ukraine. We pray especially for the turmoil going on in Brazil. We pray for turmoil going on in this nation. May peace reign through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for our enemies. O God, whom we cannot love unless we love our neighbors, remove hate and prejudice from us and from all people, so that all your children may be reconciled with those we fear, resent, or threaten, and live together in your peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for those who govern us. Mighty God, sovereign over the nations, direct those who make, administer, and judge our laws, the President of the United States and others in authority among us, the Mayor of Stone Mountain and the executives of Gwinnett and DeKalb and other counties represented in this congregation, our representatives, our governor. May they be guided by your wisdom, that they may lead us in the way of righteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for world leaders. Eternal ruler, hope of all the earth, we give vision to those who serve the United Nations, to those who govern all countries. We think of the countries represented here, United Kingdom and Nigeria and Togo and Ghana, Jamaica, the Bahamas, Guyana, for India. May these leaders break down barriers, foster understanding, and draw the world together in peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray for the sick. Merciful God, you bear the pain of the world. Look with compassion on those who are sick. We pray especially for Lisa Lauer and for Rosa Crowley, for John Gregory and Nikki Smith, for Henry Stevens, for Isaac Wood and Loretta Sams, for Leonardo Harris, for Todd Williams and Drew Maddox, for Constance Marley, for Sylvia Miller, for Lanice Fryer, for Michael Hairston, for Clyde McClendon, for Irving Simon, and for Pastor Richard Allen Farmer. We also pray for Angela Cottrell's friend, Susan, whose home burned down this week. We pray for our designated pastor nominating committee. We pray for our missionaries, for the Colemans and Margaret Garner and Willis and Suzette, for Jacqueline Huggins and Gary Lane, for Focus Community Strategies, for Annette Smith, and for Tony and Veronica Warner. Let us pray for those who sorrow. God, a comfort, stand with those who sorrow, especially for Susie Jankowski's family on the passing of her brother, Kent. For Pastor Cyril, with his uncle and several family members, for Beverly Wallace, for the Simon family. Give them assurance that neither death nor life nor things present nor things to come shall separate them from your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for friends and family. And feel free to mention aloud anyone or anything you would like to pray for at this moment. God of compassion, bless us and those we love, our friends and families, that drawing close to you, we may be drawn closer to each other through Jesus Christ our Lord. God of all generations, we praise you for all your servants who, having been faithful to you on earth, now live with you in heaven. Keep us in fellowship with them until we meet with all your children in the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Mighty God, whose word we trust, whose spirit enables us to pray, accept our requests and further those which will bring about your purpose on this earth through Jesus Christ, who reigns and rules over all things. Amen.
If you are here visiting us for the first time, we want to acknowledge your presence by getting to know your name and where you're visiting us from. If you can please rise to your feet so that we'll give you a crossroads welcome. The ushers will bring you the microphone. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. I'm Evangelist Morrison from the Church of God of Prophecy. I'm located in Violin, and I'm happy to be here with my sister-in-law, and I'm enjoying the service. Amen. Thus far. Blessing Amen. To you all.
Amen.
And it's my brother, Trevor Brown. He living here. Praise God, but he don't want to stand up.
Hello, good morning. My name is Allie. I'm visiting you from Stone Mountain. I attended this church as a child, and my family has some history here. So I've come to rekindle my relationship with the church. Thank you for having
Welcome.
Me.
Welcome.
Good morning. My name is Willistina Babb. I was invited by Julie Morgan. I live in Decatur area.
Good morning, what a blessing. My name is Yolinda Kinney, and I'm visiting from Green Forest Community Baptist Church. I was invited by Cheryl Maddox, a very dear friend of mine. Praise God.
Praise
I'm
God.
Glad to be here.
Anyway, you are all welcome. I know and I believe that your coming here is not by accident, but this is what God has really planned in the realms of the spirit, and it has happened in the physical. Be blessed. And if you are online joining us for the first time, please drop us a note by emailing the church at office@crossroads-pc.com, and someone will get back to you. Thank you. If you are able to please stand. Raising up your offering or whatever that represents your offering as we recite our stewardship affirmation. God the giver,
we thank you for these resources you have entrusted to us. As we give, we do so with grateful hearts. With cheerfulness, return a portion of your gifts that Crossroads Church may care for the financially distressed, spread the gospel to the nations, address economic and political injustices, create and sustain ministries that develop disciples of Jesus the Christ. As we give, we pray that you, Holy God, will teach us how to give. May our motives be pure, our hearts be glad, and our hands be open. We pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
If you have your offering, please bring it to the front. Father, we just want to thank and bless your name. Your word declares that we should honor you with our substance, for you are our source. Therefore, as we give joyfully, cheerfully for the work of your kingdom, we ask, O God, that Lord, you bless the work of our hands and curse the waste for us. And curse the waste, O God, from our lives in the name of Jesus. Let the heavens be open unto your people in the name which is above every other name, Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. Amen. Children ages 4 and 5 are dismissed, but children from the first to the fifth grade will not be dismissed today. Nina, is that right? Children from from the first to the fifth grade will not be dismissed today. I believe their teachers are sick today. So it's a holiday for them.
One of the ways you know that I was not raised in the American South and that my wife was is that she has all these expressions that I don't know, like round Robin Hood's barn, which I'm still not totally sure what it means. And one of hers is that if you forget something, it must have been a lie. And I finally remembered what I meant to say earlier. Must have been a lie. I decided it really wasn't worth saying, so I'm not going to say it at all. There you go. Just one of my smart remarks that wasn't worth the time of day. We've been doing a lot of up and down today, so we're going to stay seated for the reading of the scripture today. Some of you know, we're going through the book of Acts. We started at the beginning of August, and today we are in Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 22. So listen to the word of God. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple guard, and the Sadducees confronted them. They were incensed that the apostles were teaching the people and announcing that the resurrection of the dead was happening because of Jesus. They seized Peter and John and put them in prison until the next day. It was already evening. Many who heard the word became believers, and their number grew to about 5,000. The next day, the leaders, elders, and legal experts gathered in Jerusalem along with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others from the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and asked, "By what power or in what name did you do this?" Then Peter, inspired by the Holy Spirit, answered, "Leaders of the people and elders, are we being examined today because something good was done for a sick person, a good deed that healed him? If so, then you and all the people of Israel need to know that this man stands healthy before you because of the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified but whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone you builders rejected. He has become the cornerstone. Salvation can be found in no one else. Throughout the whole world, no other name has been given among humans through which we must be saved." The council was caught by surprise by the confidence with which Peter and John spoke. After all, they understood that these apostles were uneducated and inexperienced. They also recognized that they had been followers of Jesus. However, since the healed man was standing with Peter and John before their own eyes, they had no rebuttal. After ordering them to wait outside, the council members began to confer with each other. "What should we do with these men? Everyone living in Jerusalem is aware of the sign performed through them. It's obvious to everyone, and we can't deny it. To keep it from spreading further among the people, we need to warn them not to speak to anyone in his name." When they called Peter and John back, they demanded that they all stop speaking and teaching in the name of Jesus. Peter and John responded, "It's up to you to determine whether it's right before God to obey you rather than God. As for us, we can't stop speaking about what we have seen and heard." They threatened them further, then released them. Because of the public support for Peter and John, they couldn't find a way to punish them. Everyone was praising God for what had happened, because the man who experienced this sign of healing was over 40 years old. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The people of us in this room, we have different relationships with the criminal justice system. Some of us are never, ever in trouble. Maybe we never even received a speeding ticket or a parking ticket. I would not be among those. Others of us have spent time in a jail cell or perhaps even served a prison sentence. And others of us has spent at least part of our lives in fear that we would be caught for right or wrong reasons, and we would be caught by the authorities and put in prison. Now, I think most church people like us, we think of ourselves as respectable people. We're usually not the ones driving 90 miles an hour and weaving through other cars on 285 at rush hour. We're usually not the ones cursing out employees at Walmart. We're usually not the ones wearing inappropriate clothing at the steakhouse. We're respectable. Christians, by and large, are respectable people. And that just might be a problem. Turns out being respectable was not something the church in Acts could depend on. So we have this story You know, the story of Peter and John. Last week we looked, this is a continuation of the story from last week. This runs right into it. This is, they healed this man as they were going to the temple to pray. The man at the gate, Beautiful. And the man asked them for money, and they said, "We don't have money, but we'll give you what we have. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk." Now here we get Peter and John, who just did this glorious, wonderful thing, being put in jail. Why would this activity be dangerous to the people in charge? It's the concrete liberating action of God for a broken people. But in this case, the words that they said to this man put them in direct conflict with the people in power. Just as, shouldn't be a big surprise, because just as Jesus' words and deeds put him in conflict with those in power, so now those who follow Jesus also get put in conflict. It says they were incensed that the apostles were teaching the people and announcing that the resurrection of the dead was happening because of Jesus. The disciples, the apostles, literally become criminals. They are put in prison. And then it says their number grew to 5,000. Interesting evangelism technique here. Get put in prison, the church grows. Over the last couple thousand years, one of the illusions of the followers of Jesus has been, and especially those who are leaders, people who are leaders in the church, is that we could live a path different from Jesus and his disciples. There has been an illusion that somehow that we can be loved or at least liked or at least tolerated or at the worst ignored by those with real power in the world. Now let's be clear. Sometimes Christians are just obnoxious. They're jerks. We're mean. And they think that people hate them because of the gospel when it's just because they're being mean. Social media has only made this worse, where some people who call on the name of Christ seem to think that being as rude as possible to people is a way to witness to Jesus. That's not what we're talking about. The opposition to Jesus and these apostles is because they are a threat to those in power because of the life that is offered to those whom they control. This beggar at the lame man at the gate was under the control of those who had power until he could walk again. And all of a sudden he became free. Real preaching, real gospel living is real criminality. And that's a bit tough when respectability is often the idol of Christians. Because we become critics who call into question the idols of this age. Verse 10 says, "If so, then you and all the people of Israel need to know that this man stands healthy before you because of the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead." Those who are judging are builders. We are builders. We want to build it ourselves, but it says, Jesus is the stone you builders rejected. He has become the cornerstone. The temptation for those of us in the church is to think that we're the builders. We're the ones that make it happen. I love it when it says the council was caught by surprise by the confidence with which Peter and John spoke. After all, they understood the apostles were uneducated and inexperienced. One of the things that sometimes is hard for us to imagine, all of us have been taught in school to read and write. We're literate people. It was 1,500 years at least after the time of Peter and John that anyone other than a very specialized class of people knew how to read and write. They may have learned prayers in synagogue, but they couldn't have just read the scriptures. They were uneducated, and yet they speak with authority. They speak as though ones who are educated. This was a chance for those who judge, the rulers there, to cross over to themselves, respond to the teachings of Jesus. But they did not. When they called Peter and John back, they demanded that they stop all speaking and teaching in the name of Jesus. And Peter says, as for us, we can't. We can't stop. This is not an instance of the individual Peter being bold. This is Peter and John in the company of the faithful who is bold. It's all, we talked about this a few weeks ago. It's easy to tell stories and make singular heroes. But the story here is about a community that is together witnessing to the gospel. Peter is their spokesperson here, but it'll be other people who are spokespersons in other places. Think of it like this. Peter's more like the person in a choir singing a solo part than he is the soloist singing all by himself. Now, I have to admit, I get a little nervous when I hear Christians in the United States start talking about being persecuted for their faith. I am suspicious. Now, we can say all kinds of things about God and nothing dangerous happens. God is great. God is good. Now we thank you for our food. Doesn't usually get us in trouble, right? Sometimes I feel like we know that Christians in other parts of the world are persecuted, do live under difficult conditions. Sometimes it feels like we're a little jealous that we aren't persecuted as much. And so we just start making stuff up and calling it persecution. Someone in the Christmas season wishes us well with happy holidays, and we decide they're trying to destroy our Christian faith, when what they're really trying to do is to also be welcoming to Jews and Muslims in the community, or people of no faith. There's nothing wrong with a clerk at a store wishing people a joyous holiday season. We make up stories, and these really are made up, of what Starbucks puts on their cups, and think that when we buy our $5 latte that somehow we're being persecuted for our faith. You can give up your $5 latte. That would be one step. But the other one is actually to know what's going on and find out they're actually not satanic symbols. Sometimes we go out of our way to look for things. Let's not examine every sign in the mall to see if we're being sidelined as Christians. Let us not go out and do something obnoxious in public so that people will jeer and yell at us so that we can claim that we're being persecuted for our faith. Instead, let our very life and ministry be so transformative that we're a threat to that which holds on to destructive and non-life-giving forms of life. If we're going to be persecuted, if we're going to experience resistance, let's do it for something that matters. I don't have many heroes in life. I'm not someone who goes and collects autographs or things like that. But I have a hero in life, a man from Atlanta who died recently, John Lewis. John Lewis, we're going to have a picture of him put up in a minute, was famous for a phrase that he used in the political realm. Speak up, speak out, get in the way, get in good trouble, necessary trouble. Can you go ahead and put that photo up? I'll keep talking. Now, he ended that sentence talking about how this was a thing to do to save the United States as a country. I want to reclaim Lewis's language of good trouble back to where he got the idea in the first place. From stories like Peter and John and Acts 4, where you get in trouble for doing good. When Lewis spoke of good trouble, he was speaking from experience. This is John Lewis's booking photo when he was arrested as a member of the Freedom Riders in 1961, protesting against the segregation in the South, the persistence of segregation in the South following Supreme Court decisions outlawing segregation in public spaces. Can you go to the next slide? There it is. That is John Lewis being beaten by police at the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama in 1965, during a march protesting Sheriff Jim Clark's efforts to stop black folk from being able to register to vote. John Lewis believed that Christian faith called on him to get in good trouble. That phrase, good trouble, the way Acts says it is, are we being examined today because something good was done for a sick person? It's not good as in pleasant. It's trouble that comes from doing good. To use Lewis's language, the trouble, the criminality, you can take that down. The criminality that Peter and John were implicated in was because they had healed the lame man. What good would be better than that? So let me ask you a question. What's the kind of good that we at Crossroads might pursue that might get us into good trouble? Or the other phrase John Lewis used, necessary trouble. What if we loved business people into the kingdom in such a way that they became part of this community and as a result had to reform their business practices such that profits went down and enemies were made? What if we were so welcoming to unhoused persons that we became their spiritual home and our neighbors got nervous about our presence in the neighborhood? What if we were so good at breaking down cultural and racial boundaries that traditional political alliances in the county were threatened? What if we looked at the lack of affordable, safe housing in the area and said, yes, in my backyard, deciding to use some of our church property to help families build solid financial futures, but ticked off some community leaders? What if we became the church community that helped some of those families in that housing come to faith in Christ? What if our proclamation of the gospel through word and through our lives was so compelling that too many people joined this community and caused traffic jams on Sunday morning? What if we were so faithful to the gospel that we became a little less respectable, a little less put together, a little rough on the edges? Because we weren't playing by the rules of those who are in power. We cannot and must not allow our respectability to be an obstacle to faithfulness. Amen. Let me say that again. We cannot allow our sense of respectability to be an obstacle to faithfulness. When we are faithful, we can expect resistance. Let's see if we can get into some good trouble, some necessary trouble, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. We reflect now as we prepare to come to this table. The story of Acts is the story of a community that comes together, that comes and eats together, that comes and prays together, that comes into the presence of God together. This is the joyful feast of the people of God. The scriptures say that people will come from east and west and north and south to sit at table with the Lord. According to Luke, when Jesus was with his disciples on that evening after they'd walked to Emmaus, Jesus sat at the table and he took bread and broke it and blessed it and their eyes were opened and they recognized him. Today we bless and break. May we recognize Jesus together. Our Savior invites all those who trust in him to share this feast that he has prepared. In a few minutes, we will pass out the trays, first the bread and then the cup. The bread we will hold and eat together. The cup you can partake of whenever you feel appropriate to do so. We have both the separate and we have the kits that will be passed out if that is something that is the way you would prefer to receive the elements. Can we move to the... little hard one, we can't see the The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks, O God, creator of the universe. In your wisdom, you made all things and sustained them by your power. You formed us in your image to love and serve you and to live in peace with your creation. But we rebelled against you, and you did not abandon us, but sent prophets to call us back to your way. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to redeem us and to heal our brokenness. Therefore, we join our voices with the choirs of heaven and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever praise your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed in the Lord's name, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the Lord's name, Hosanna in the highest.
O holy God, we thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son. In Jesus, born of Mary, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. He lived as one of us, knowing our joy and sorrow. He healed the sick. He fed the hungry. He welcomed sinners, and he proclaimed good news to the poor. Dying on the cross, he gave himself for the life of the world. Rising from the grave, he won for us victory over death. Seated at your right hand, he reigns with you in glory and will come again to make all things new. Remembering the risen Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this cup as we live for the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer you now the sacrifice of our lives, for great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
O gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Jesus. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. In union with your church, in heaven and on earth, we pray, O God, that you will fulfill your eternal purpose in us and all the world. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm, through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Jesus was with us. He took bread, and after giving thanks, he blessed and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he gave it to them, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins." Apostle Paul tells us, as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would the servers please come forward? This is the body of Christ given for you. Please share that with one another as you pass. The body of Christ given for you.
Thy holy word, good
But he's done, so we can do it this way. Body of Christ given for you. 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 Can you serve me? This is the body of Christ given for you. God, we are thankful. We are thankful that you have sent your Son, Jesus, for us. We are thankful that you have fed us on this heavenly food, that your Spirit is alive within us as a community. Help us to be faithful proclaimers of your gospel in all that we do and say. In Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Let us stand and sing to the glory of God.
Jesus, I surrender all to Him.
Service, maybe while we were singing, or maybe when the communion elements were being passed, you were thinking that you would like to think more deeply and make a stronger commitment or make a new commitment to following Jesus. Talk to me on the way out. There are people here who can help you in that. I need to make one announcement. Right as soon as the service ends, so there's going to be cake and conversation with the Sofadillas. You can go greet the chief and learn about his immense power that he now has, that right after the service. So go out there. There we go. People of God, as you leave this place, do so with a commitment to get in good trouble, to get in the necessary trouble of following Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
That the world might see the true nature of that kingdom that we've been called to, that disrupts the way things are for the way things could be. We say that, we commit to that in the name of Jesus Christ, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.